in contemporary terms, that first Palm Sunday was maybe like a ticker tape parade down the streets of Manhattan, welcoming the return of a great hero. It was a grand and glorious occasion. It was Passover time, and Jews were in Jerusalem from all over the world. It was the ambition of the faithful to observe at least one Passover feast in Jerusalem and celebrate that time when the death angel had passed over their homes and God had delivered their ancestors from bondage and captivity and slavery in Egypt. And so on that day, as Jesus headed towards Jerusalem, accompanied by an enthusiastic crowd that had witnessed his mighty works in Bethany, and when he got to the outskirts of the city, he was met by another crowd of Passover pilgrims. And when the joyful Bethany crowd met the expectant Jerusalem crowd, the atmosphere of Passover was all around them. It's an atmosphere of joy and celebration and a spontaneous combustion of excitement and spirit broke out. Jesus was riding a donkey. He was received as a conquering king. Some cut palm branches from trees, waved them in the air, spread them along the road. Others took their garments and spread them along the road out of reverence and respect. The multitude sang, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of our God. The Messiah has come. Our sovereign has arrived. Ride on, King Jesus." But you know, it's fairly easy to be a part of a Palm Sunday crowd. Everybody likes a winner. Everybody likes to ride on the coattails of someone else or be on the team of somebody who seems to be going places. And maybe that explains in part what is happening in this current presidential race. We're caught up in a celebrity culture, and people see who they think is a winner and on top and lead their lives vicariously through celebrities. If Donald Trump can be a millionaire many times over, why not me? I heard one reporter say the other day that really what people are doing with Donald Trump is buying a lottery ticket and hoping they'll hit it big. But what we have here is a childish man who, with very superficial grasp of the issues, is seeking a position that requires seasoned maturity. He is the embodiment of this celebrity culture, a world filled with glitz and hype and fantasy and illusion. But things are not what they seem. It's a culture in which shallow perception is more valuable than deep insight. Watching Trump perform his shtick, you hear pretty much the same thing every time he gets up. He comes on stage, recites his poll numbers, insults his opponents, even sometimes incites violence. It's shameful. Invites famous supporters to the stage, sings his praises, then talks endlessly without giving concrete, factual examples about how bad things are and how he's going to make things better and make America great again, and millions are falling forward. And I think maybe that in part was what was going on with that crowd's reaction to Jesus. People saw him as a winner. They didn't really know who he was. He was the one they thought who would make the nation great again. He was the one who would build that wall and keep all of the bad people out. For those who see Jesus as a celebrity, only a conquering sovereign, living up to their own expectations, miss out on the real message, ministry, and meaning of the Christ. Those who don't go beyond a Palm Sunday mentality miss out on the essence of the gospel of Jesus Christ. To really understand who Jesus was, what he was about, what he can do for us, and what he has called us to do for him, I just wanted to stand and say that we got to go beyond. Thank God for Palm Sunday. We all hear Palm Sunday, but we've got to go beyond Palm Sunday. We've got to go beyond the parade of the celebrity to the practice, pain, and promise of our faith. We've got to follow Jesus on that Monday after Palm Sunday, when he saw merchants buying and selling in the temple, and he drove them out of the temple. He said, "It is written, my house shall be called a house of prayer, but you've made it a den of thieves." In other words, as we grow beyond our Palm Sunday naivete, we come to grips with the imperfections in the church. Everybody in the church, you see, is not, quote, saved. Everybody under the steeple is not holy. Everything done in the name of Jesus is not right. So we learn we don't have to put the church down just because there are some imperfect folks up in here. People say, well, the reason I don't join the church is because there are so many hypocrites. Well, there are hypocrites everywhere. Welcome. Come on in. You fit right in. We've got to learn to serve Jesus not only on Sunday, but on Monday. But listen, don't stop on Monday. Go on to Tuesday. For what happened on Tuesday? It was on Tuesday that Jesus ran into those who questioned his authority and tried to discredit his name. And we need to learn to follow Jesus even on a Tuesday, when we come face to face with those on our jobs, and even in our homes, who try to discredit who we are. You've got to be able to stand up and not be intimidated by negative folks. For it was on Tuesday that you discover that righteousness has its foes, joy has its enemies, peace has its pickpockets, hope has its hijackers. But you can't let anybody pick at your peace, steal your sweetness, jail your joy, or hijack your hope. But don't stop on Tuesday either. No, you shout on Sunday. You come to grips with the imperfections of the church on Monday. You run into cynics and critics on Tuesday, but go on to Wednesday. For it was on Wednesday that Judas, one of Jesus' own chosen disciples, made contact with the authorities to betray him. But also on Wednesday, according to Matthew and Mark, while Jesus was dining, he received one of the last acts of kindness of his earthly life. A woman, out of heartfelt gratitude, put a bottle of costly perfume on Jesus and anointed his body. It was a holy waste, and thank God for it. One of the painful lessons that we learned when we go beyond Palm Sunday is that every church, every family, every circle of friends and associates has a Judas. Sometimes those who do us the greatest harm are not those out there somewhere, but those within and who are very close. But for every Judas who betrays our trust, there's someone else who responds to our kindness with an act of love and thanksgiving. For every Judas who discourages us, there's someone else to lift our spirits. For every Judas who tears us down, there's someone else to build us up. For every Judas who digs a ditch, there's someone else who anoints us for greater service. For every Judas who hurts us, there's someone else to comfort us. But don't stop. Don't stop on Wednesday either. Go on to Thursday. Follow Jesus up those steps to the upper room where he sat with his disciples at the Last Supper, broke bread and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." He took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them saying, "Drink of it, all of it, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. And Father, Jesus on Thursday into that garden and hear him praying, Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but your will be done. When you go the distance beyond Palm Sunday, you learn how to pray your way through your darkest hour. You learn how to trust God even in those places where you can't trace God. You learn how to say, God, I don't understand it, but your will be done. You follow him on Thursday, even as he stands before his accusers with power to destroy them, but he never says a mumbling word. But don't stop on Thursday. Go on to Friday. You come too far now. You got to go on to Friday. Now, Thursday was dark, but Friday was darker still. Friday is that time when they talk about you and call you everything but a child of God. Friday is that time when you're down and it looks like you will never get up again. Friday is that time when you're in that tunnel and you can see no light at the end. Friday is when your best bosom buddies turn their backs on you. That's Friday. You know, they mocked him on Friday. They humiliated him on Friday. They spat on him on Friday. They crucified him on Friday. They shouted, you saved others, now save yourself on Friday. The sun refused to shine on Friday. Can you follow Jesus on Friday as they led him out to Golgotha, the town's garbage dump? Hung him high, stretched him wide, and dropped him low. Can you follow him on Friday? Must Jesus bear the cross alone and all the world go free? No, there's a cross for everyone, and there's a cross for me. That's Friday. And what about Saturday, silent Saturday, those times in your life when you can't hear nobody pray? Can you still give God the glory even on silent Saturday? And I hear somebody asking, does the gospel end there? Is that the end of the story? No, 1,000 times no. Matthew records the crucifixion in chapter 27, but there's another chapter. Mark records the crucifixion in chapter 15, but there's another chapter. Luke records the crucifixion in chapter 23 of his gospel, but there is another chapter. John has the crucifixion in chapter 19, but there are two more chapters. Never forget that there's always another chapter beyond Friday and Saturday. There's always another chapter beyond suffering and tribulation, another chapter beyond sin and Satan, another chapter beyond trouble and trial. Somebody here today even needs to know that there's another chapter. You thought your failure was final, but there is another chapter. It may be dark in your life now, but there's another chapter. It is a chapter that tells of faithful women who went to the tomb to anoint a dead body, but received a message from living angels about a living Jesus. Calvary could not destroy him. Death could not keep him in the grave and hold him. I don't know about you, but I think I'm going to run on now and see what the end's going to be. I'm going to run on and shout the victory, for the real victory was not seen by that Palm Sunday crowd, but by those long-distance marathon runners who went all the way. I tell you, my sisters and brothers, if we witness for Jesus on Monday, defend him on Tuesday, comfort him on Wednesday, pray with him on Thursday, bear a cross with him on Friday, wait for him on Saturday, then we can get up on Sunday and shout the victory. Let's go the distance. Let's go the distance beyond the parade of palms, to the practice, pain, and promise of our faith. Amen.